Oh, hey, Matt.
Hey, Beth.
Sorry, I almost ran into you.
Yeah, walking and texting, not a good
idea. No, not a good idea.
Sorry about that.
It's all right. That's right. How you doing? Great to see you.
Doing okay. Kind of conference on the brain. I mean, general conference a few weeks ago, getting ready for annual conference. Jurisdictional conference is coming. Just a lot of conference on the brain right now.
Right, I can understand that.
Yeah.
This was your first time at general conference, right?
Yeah, it was.
What did you think?
It was okay. Yeah. You know, there were some parts that I thought were really great. You know, it was really neat to meet people from literally around the world, people of different languages and cultures, and yet finding ourselves united as United Methodists and in faith in Christ, and just getting to experience that and their spirit. I mean, it was great to meet those folks. At our table that we were sitting at General Conference, it was myself and one other delegate here from the Susquehanna Conference, but we had four folks from South Africa.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and it was really cool because I couldn't speak their language real well, but there was a connection with them, and just a neat spirit. And I was sitting there the one afternoon, and I'd accidentally gotten my bag in front of the gentleman beside me and in his way. And so I reached over and I pulled my bag away, and I said, "I'm so sorry, I didn't mean to have my stuff in your way." And just without hesitation, he reached over and he put his hand on my hand and on my arm and just said, no, your problem is my problem.
Oh,
and
wow.
I thought, wow, it's, you know, that's such a cool thing.
So just,
that kind of stuff is great.
That is. That's a neat feeling. And I can't help but notice, though, when you were talking in the beginning, you had a little bit of hesitation when you were thinking about General Conference. I assume it wasn't all sweetness and light for you.
You caught that?
Yeah.
Yeah, there were some parts that were a little difficult. I mean, honestly, I went and I expected some politics. I expected some agenda making. But I think I underestimated how much of that would be going on. It just seemed like every time I turned a corner, somebody was having a conversation about how they could advance their agenda,
right?
Because they didn't trust anyone else to do it for them. And it seemed like the more we focused on advancing our own agenda, the less we trusted one another. And you experienced this in some of your sessions, but one session I was in, I mean, we just had this complete devolving into chaos, literally, because we weren't willing to trust each other and what we were trying to do to move ahead.
And what's hard about that is, I think you and I have both experienced something very different at our own annual conference, so it was more of a shock to encounter it at General Conference.
Absolutely. I mean, for me, I think that was one of my struggles, because last year at our annual conference, we did some amazing things. We passed the redistricting, and we did that not knowing what the ramifications would be. We did that not knowing what all the details were going to be or how that was even going to affect us, and yet we did that overwhelmingly. So I guess I thought the same or similar thing would happen at General Conference and was rather let down when it didn't.
I can understand that.
Sure.
Trust is something that's not easy to come by, and it's something that's hard to continue to nurture
and
to strengthen.
It really is. And so I'm getting ready for annual conference this year, and part of my thinking goes, you know, we trusted one another last year, but are we going to be able to trust each other this year? Because the thing about trust is it's easy to talk about trust in a vacuum, but when it hits us personally, it's a whole different story. Just yesterday morning, I was sitting in our clergy session.
And over at Brubaker.
Over at Brubaker. And we went through our itinerancy vows.
Right.
And sitting there in the safety of Brubaker, I just kind of went through them and I meant them. But it was easy and it was safe because there were no real impacts on me. But about a year ago, I got a call from my DS. And let me just say, I trust my DS and I trust the cabinet. But in that moment, when I got that phone call, I'm not sure I trusted them a whole lot because I was convinced we were in the middle of a great ministry.
Yeah.
I didn't think my kids were at the best age to move.
Right.
I thought, I don't know that I can trust you with this decision. And yet, what has been amazing to me a year later is especially looking back and seeing God's hand in that entire process.
Yeah.
But it's a way different story when that trust becomes personal and affects how I live.
Yeah, I really hear that, Matt. Now that I'm kind of sitting on the other side of the table and for the last few years kind of being in the midst of that appointment discussion, I've really been amazed at how much time is spent, not just at the cabinet table, but throughout the year, for superintendents to try to connect with the pastors to see where they're at, where their churches are at, what's going on with their families, you know, what's that going to be about, and then to sit around that table and recognize that the decisions that are made are going to drastically impact the lives of these folks. It's a weighty time.
Absolutely.
And this year especially, it seemed like a very long appointment
season. I saw the list of retirements.
Right. So we started with this big list of retirees.
Right.
And you know, that's a lot of churches to fill, and we had some interims that were out there, some great interims where we needed to begin to have some solid leadership come in behind what they had done.
Right.
It was an amazing process. It's an amazing process to witness as we sit around that table. Each time that we come to an appointment, I was struck at how prayerfully we approach that.
Right.
It's a time of deep discernment. We even light a candle, you know, for every appointment as we talk about it.
You do that for everyone that comes through.
Every appointment, and to prayerfully, silent prayer and verbal prayer, and we even sing a chorus. I mean, we are really very invested in each and every appointment.
Right.
And I know that there have been, at least for me, and I know for my colleagues, many sleepless nights where you just tossed and turned, wrestling with where is the Holy Spirit guiding us for this particular church or this appointment.
Beth, as you were saying that, I obviously feel the weight of those decisions, even as you're describing that. But I'm curious, knowing how heavily that weight is upon you, that's a lot of times decisions regarding others. When the issue of trust becomes personal, though, and affects your own personal life and what's going to happen for you, how do you respond to that?
Well, this year I can speak directly to that. I'm moving.
To
Williamsport. In fact, actually a week from today, the moving van will be pulling up to the Williamsport District Parsonage, and we'll be unloading our
annual
things.
Conference 1 week, moving the next.
That's exactly right. And not only will I be starting in a new district, but it's a new way of approaching superintendency.
Right, because a year ago, you didn't, making that vote, you didn't know what it would mean to be a district superintendent or even where you were going to do it.
That's exactly right. In fact, I was up here on stage when we took that vote, and I remember looking out over the annual conference and seeing all those hands go up when we voted for the redistricting, and my heart went, oh, yay!
Absolutely.
You know, this is exciting. But then there was another part of me that went, oh, what will this mean for me personally?
Right.
And I realized that at that moment, that I had to fully put my trust in this body,
right,
not just for the vision of the annual conference, but for the direction of my own life. And that really hit home to me at how much we have to trust each other in this annual conference and how important it is for that trust to lead us down that road together.
I guess that's the question, isn't it, Beth? Will we travel together? Will we trust one another to travel together? I think for me, at General Conference this year, that was the piece that was missing, that we never named. And now here we are, we find ourselves coming up to our annual conference, and I wonder, will we trust one another to travel together, to move ahead to wherever God may be calling us?
It is indeed the heart of the cabinet to be able to take seriously the vision of our annual conference, to be able to resource and to lead and to pray for and to guide in any way that we can our leaders, our churches, our pastors, our laity into effective, passionate ministry for Jesus Christ. Because that is our heart. We want people to know Jesus Christ. And that is an exciting place to be in ministry together. Sometimes when decisions are made, hurt can occur. Sometimes when decisions are made, there is a sense of a lack of communication. Sometimes when decisions are made, people feel like they didn't understand the new direction that was being taken. But I can tell you from my heart, and I know the heart of my colleagues, that there is, at the end of that journey, a common vision together with every single person that we minister with. We want people to know the heart of Jesus Christ. And we are excited to be able to travel that road together with you.
When I was first asked to serve on the visioning leadership team, my first reaction was one of skepticism. I, like many of you, am busy. I have a lot of things that I can fill my time with, and I thought, is this really worth it? Because I do not want to sit on just another committee. I do not want to make just more programs that will fall away in a year or two or three. is this really going to be worth my time? But you just heard some of the sentiments that Beth expressed, and it has been such a joy for me to find myself on the Vision Leadership Team and with the Cabinet, finding myself rubbing elbows with people who genuinely want to see our churches become all that God has intended them to be, and willing to say, we will do whatever it takes in order to make disciples for Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. And we will try new things and risk new things, even when we're not sure what the results are going to be. And that has been such a great encouragement to me. As I mentioned, time is a precious thing, and we always wonder how best can we use it. One of the things that I have found myself being grateful for is the opportunity to serve in this capacity, because I believe in what we are doing. I believe that this is going to have results, not just for today, but more importantly, for tomorrow. And I believe that God is somehow at work moving us in the right direction. I would not continue or want to be a part of this team if I didn't sense that, and more importantly, sense it from those around me. What a joy it has been for me to genuinely experience that God is moving anew and afresh in ways that I personally have never experienced before. And I can't wait to see what God is going to do among us. I would like to invite you in the next few moments. You are going to hear some different ideas about how we can do life differently together so that more disciples of Jesus Christ can be made in our own local churches. And all I ask in that time is that we approach that with a spirit of openness and prayer and humility for God's guidance among us, that we too could trust one another for wherever God is going to lead. And I'm excited about where God is leading. I do not believe that God is done with us yet, or I wouldn't continue to serve on this team. It gives me hope, and it gives me encouragement about what God is doing. So I invite us this day to open our hearts and our minds for conversation about where God is leading, and most of all, that we can do it in a spirit of trust as we examine different ideas about where God is leading us.
Reconcile the children to the fathers, and with forgiveness and mercy,